Welcome to the Green Castle Baptist Church online Bible study experience. It is our prayer that God continues to bless and keep you. Green Castle Baptist Church is located at 4970 Murphy Lane here in Louisville, Kentucky. Our pastor is the Reverend James R. Pitts. Thank you for viewing our online Bible study experience. We will now join a recent Bible study.
Going to start a study of the survey of the Gospel of John. The background to John's Gospel is that John writes simple, in a simple, straightforward style. And you'll notice something in John's Gospel, he's fond of contrast. You'll see contrast he uses like of light and dark, life and death. And a story in John's Gospel may jump from sadness and all of a sudden it's ecstasy. It may jump from storms and next thing you know, everything is calm. John reads like a scrapbook, really, of the life of Jesus Christ. Someone asked me years ago, said, why are there four Gospels? Well, a picture is more complete when it's taken from several different angles. Each Gospel writer looks at Jesus from his, meaning the Gospel writer's, own distinct angle. For example, you take Matthew. Matthew was writing to a certain group of people. He was writing primarily to the Jews. And you do remember Matthew. He used to be a former tax collector for the Roman government. And so Matthew, his idea is to establish the regal rights of Jesus as the king of the Jews. That's why in Matthew he has the background and it's a genealogy of Jews. He shows Jesus as the Messiah, the one whom the Jews have been waiting on for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. He shows him as the Redeemer. He shows Jesus, he portrays him as the King. He's writing to the Jews. And then Mark is writing to primarily for the Romans. And that's why Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels, only 16 chapters. He shows Jesus as the servant, because really the Romans wouldn't really be impressed by anything a Jew particularly did, because the Jews were part of a conquered nation. And so Mark shows Jesus as a servant. In Mark, you find no genealogy. Mark has no family background because he knows that his readers, the Jews, would not be interested. Romans would not be interested in the background of a Jew. Another thing about Mark, you'll find words all through the book of Mark like straightway and immediately. There's a lot of activity. And that would appeal to his listeners who were the Romans, because the Romans were interested more in deeds and in actions. And then there's Luke, the Gospel of Luke. Luke was a Greek, by the way, who was writing to the Greeks primarily. And in Luke, it's an interesting book. He focuses more on Jesus' humanity. And he traced Jesus' background, his genealogy, all the way back to Adam, the first man. And so Luke also pictures Jesus, therefore, as the Son of Man, kind of what the Jews call the kinsman redeemer. He's the redeemer of the whole earth. And so you find no genealogy in the book of Luke either, because the Greeks would not be interested, just like the Romans, in the background of I tell you something else you find in Luke. You'll find more description of the physicality of Jesus, especially like on the cross. Luke gives more, he gives more time to explaining and painting the picture of what Jesus faced on the cross, what he suffered on the cross. And here again, the reason for that, remember, Luke was a physician. And so, and then we have the gospel that we're gonna look at, the gospel of John. John is writing to an audience that you would call a universal audience. John's writing is timeless. He stresses the deity of Jesus. There is no genealogy in the Gospel of John. John doesn't, his readers, he says, we're not going to look at where Jesus came from, his ancestors. We want to see what he did, why he came. And so you'll find in the Gospel of John, you will find no account of Jesus' birth. You'll find no account of Jesus' baptism. You'll find no account of the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness by the devil. There's nothing in John's account about the Last Supper, Gethsemane, and Jesus ascending back to the Father. There's nothing in John's gospel about Jesus healing people possessed by demons or evil spirits. He heals some folks, but not those two categories. And in John's gospel, you'll find none of the parables that you will find, for example, in the book of Matthew. But John's gospel contains some things that are omitted by the other gospel writers. Only in John's gospel where you see the story of the wedding feast at Cana, where Jesus turned the water to wine. Only in John's gospel, in chapter 11, where it talks about raising his friend Lazarus from the dead. Only in John's gospel does it talk about Jesus washing the disciples' feet. Only in John's gospel does it talk about Jesus teaching about the Holy Spirit as a divine comforter. Only in John's gospel will you find stories of disciple Thomas and disciple Andrew and disciple Philip. Again, John shows Jesus in full light of his deity. He does not spend a lot of time on the humanity of Jesus. He talks about it, yes, but his writers, what he wants his writers to know, see, and understand is that Jesus is the Son of the living God. That's why he starts off, and I'm a little ahead of myself, but he starts off and says, in the beginning was the Word. He's talking about Jesus. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John's gospel, of course, as you know, is the fourth gospel, and John was the son of a man named Zebedee. He had a brother named James. And they, James and John and Simon Peter, formed what is known as the inner circle of Jesus Christ. They were real close to Jesus. They were the closest companions that he had. And when you look at John's gospel, and you ask yourself, well, what is the motive for John's gospel? Why did John write this gospel? Well, you have to go almost all the way back to the end of the gospel, the chapter 20. And if we get to 20 in verses 30 and 31, it gives you the reason for the motive for John's gospel. It says, and many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. Why? But that these that are written, that they might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. And as a matter of fact, the word believe is one of John's favorite words. And the reason I say that, it must be a favorite word. He used it 98 times in his gospel. And then he uses, you'll see, phrases to depend upon and words like trust. He uses them over and over. And so, what is his method? Well, his method, we just read it in John 20, 30 and 31. His method is to show the many signs that Jesus made. And when I say signs refers to an act a miracle even that is full of meaning, not just a display of natural power, not just turning water to wine, but it's a dynamic way of pointing out some aspect of the person of Jesus Christ. John in his gospel records seven such signs, and each of these signs that he records are concrete demonstrations that Jesus is God. These seven miracles occur during Jesus' public ministry. And a second key to understanding the structure of the book of John is found in John chapter 1, but verses 11 and 12, which read, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." And so I looked at this and I said to myself, well, what does "he came to his own" mean? And what did his own do or not do? How did Jesus relate to those who were not his own? And near the end of the gospel, we'll see something, that God will accept the Gentiles as his children and heirs, just like he will believing Jews. And so we go into part one, and we call that, we name that the Son of God, part one, found in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. John establishes the deity of Christ by giving us a glimpse of him before the foundations of the earth. As I said in verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so he establishes before the foundation of the earth, Jesus was at the beginning. Also, if you could read Psalms chapter 90, verses 1 and 2, as a companion scripture. And so in where we are now, John introduces Jesus, and he calls him something that's kind of strange. He says, he calls him the Word, the Word. And I wonder why he called him the Word. I said, well, you know, Jesus came as a baby, and he called him the Word. Jesus, he called him the Word because Jesus was the final spokesman for God. These were found. And in Hebrews chapter 1, and begin, I think in the first two verses of Hebrews chapter 1, we get a little background to that reasoning. It says, God, who at sundry times and in divers manner, that's King James, that means various times, spoke in times past unto the fathers of the prophets, you know, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, all of them. But in these last days, verse 2, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, and by whom also he made the world. Jesus is the heir, but he's also the creator. Interesting. And some, he was saying, Jesus was with God face to face in eternity past. Yet in some mysterious way, the Word Jesus was not only with God, but the Word was God. And I mean, many years ago, it was a young person, and they said, well, look here, I don't understand the Trinity. I said, well, don't feel like the Lone Ranger, because there are a lot of theologians that still wrestle with it. I said, but let me try to explain it as best I can. I said, you have a father? And the young man said, yeah. I said, so your father is John Jones, but your father, John Jones, is also the husband of Mrs. Jones. And so he's your daddy, he's your mama's husband, and he's his mama's son. He's one man, but he's got three functions. He's a man, He's a husband. He a dad. One man. And that's where Jesus is. Don't tell me. I know it's a mystery. It's hard for us to grasp. But that's what the Bible teaches. Jesus was not simply the revealer of God, but he was God himself revealed. Ah, that's what I'm trying to get. And so in the beginning, the text says in John that Jesus was there. And verses 2 and 3 expand on his role in creation. It says the same, talking about Jesus, was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Two facts about Jesus' deity are expressed in those verses. Number one, Christ himself was not created. Christ was not created. All things, and secondly, all things were created by him. God the Father, let me break it down so you, was the architect, but Jesus was the primary agent of creation. In 1 Corinthians, let's look at chapter 8, verse 6. Interesting, it says, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Jesus, that's why Jesus said on one occasion, somebody said, well, Jesus, especially those that didn't believe, they said, well, now who do you think you are? How do you explain your connection to God the Father? He said, it's very simple. He said, listen to me. He said, the Father and I are one. And in other words, he was saying, if you've seen me, you've seen my daddy. And if you see my daddy, you see me. The Father and I are one. And something else I found out, that Jesus also sustains the universe. And in Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, it reads, for by him, talking about Jesus, all things were created that are in heaven, in earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, or all things were created by him, and check this out, and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Boy, that's a mouthful. Basically, what that text is saying, what Paul is saying to the Colossians, he said, God the Son was the creator. In other words, and what I like, he says, and by him all things consist. There's a reason that earth does not run into Venus. There's a reason that the planets don't run into each other every 4 or 5 years. There's a reason, because God is in control. There's a pattern to the universe, and there is an order about the universe. And behind all of the creation in this universe stands Jesus the Christ. He was the one crucial and dynamic element. He is life. And so it also goes on to say that Jesus is the source of all physical life. He's the source of all spiritual life. And then we're told later on, and we'll see, of John the Baptist's ministry in relation to this life-giving life. I want to read verses 6 and 7 of John chapter 1. And it seems like in verse 5 and 6, it doesn't seem like there's a bridge between the verses. It goes and talking about light shining in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not. And then, bam, verse 6 said, there was a man, and he was sent from God, and his name was John. The same came for witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. Now, it lets us know, verse 8, John was not that light, but he was sent to bear witness of the light. And then in those verses, John reveals the roles of Jesus. John the Baptist was the messenger. Jesus Christ was the Messiah. And as a matter of fact, some folk got to asking John the Baptist one day, they said, "Hey man, you've been out here preaching down here, you must be the Messiah." John said, "No, no, no. Y'all got the wrong one, it ain't me." He said, "When the Messiah comes, I'm not even worthy to bend down and unlatch his sandals. No, I am not the one." They said, "Well, who are you?" He said, "If you want to give me a title, call me Voice." He said, "I'm a voice crying in the wilderness." And then John, it said in the text that we read, that talks about light. And four things can be said of light in these verses. The light that the Bible talks about originates with Jesus. As a matter of fact, all light does. When it said, "Let there be light," in Genesis, "Let there be light." Light originates with the Lord. And then it says something in verse, let's look at John chapter 1. Verse 4. "In him was life, and the light was the light of men." But look at verse 5. So this says it originates with Christ. Verse 5 says, "And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." By comprehended, the King James Version, it means that the light that shined could not be overpowered by darkness. And then third, when you down verse 9, "That was the true light, which light of every man that comes into the world." And so this light is different from just regular light. It's the true light. It is the true light. It is unique in its origin. And then in the latter part of verse 9, it says, "This light is universally available." It says, "Which lighteth every man that come into the world." It enlightens every person. So this light is available to everybody. And so then I'm going to talk about the Son of Earth. In spite of the fact that Jesus offers himself to everyone without exception, his light is shunned by many. Some folks just don't want to be bothered with his light. Look at verse 10. It said, "He was in the world. The world was made by him." But here's the sad part. "And the world knew him not." And one of the reasons the world didn't know him, because they didn't want to know him. Verse 11 says, "He came unto his own, and his own received him not." He came to his own folks. Talking about the Jews. Came unto his own, but they received him not. But verse 12 says, and here's where we fall in. Verse 12 says, "But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God." Those verses just say there are a whole lot of folk. When Jesus was around, they refused to step into the light of Christ. They even refused to acknowledge Jesus Christ as creator. You remember one time the Gospels record, Jesus went back to town. He'd been on a preaching engagement and preaching and stuff, and folk all around different little towns around Nazareth was talking about, "Woo, that guy sure can tell a story. We ain't never heard a man talk like this, man." And when he got home, in his neighborhood, where he grew up for 30 years, when he got home, folks in his own hometown said, "Oh man, he ain't nothing. You know, I mean, you know, Messiah, man, come on, man. I know his mama, I know his daddy, I know all his brothers and sisters. They live over on 26th Street, so man, he ain't no Messiah. You know, he ain't nothing." And there was like a veil, there was a blinder that folk could not see. Many refused to see, but that has not changed in 2020. There are still millions who refuse to see that Jesus is the light of the world. I guess maybe they have been around in darkness so long that darkness has become a way of life. They cannot think any other way but dark thoughts and dark understandings. And so darkness has enveloped them. Not only did the creation not know him, that means the folk, but even Jesus' own people, as I said, the Jews, didn't receive him. Fortunately, Some of them did. And John records it. There was a little lady who had a bad reputation in town, especially amongst the ladies. And so she had to come draw water, but she had to wait till they got their water first. And then she came. We call her the Samaritan woman, as recorded in John chapter 4. And then there was another lady that said they had caught her, the religious leaders had caught her in the very act of adultery. And that's in John chapter 8, but she came to Jesus. And then there was a blind man in chapter 9. Folk kind of didn't pay much attention to him, but Jesus did. He called his name and Jesus heard. And so it takes us to Jesus is the Son of God. But first of all, he's the Son of God in the flesh. Verse 14 of John chapter 1 says, and the Word, y'all heard this 100 times, was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The theologians call that the incarnation of Christ. And of course, carnation comes from the root word for carnal, means flesh, bodily. And so it was saying in effect that deity found itself into humanity. Jesus, Son of God, born by Mary. John the Baptist testified about it. Verse 15, it said, John bear witness of him and crying, saying, this is he whom I was talking about. He that comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. John saw Jesus. John was busy baptizing. And let me tell you, if you ever baptize anybody, you have to keep your mind focused on what you're doing, because you might drop somebody. And so he had his mind, and he's baptizing folk. And in my mind, I see the picture. The picture is, while he's baptizing somebody, he looks up and he sees Jesus coming. He sees Jesus coming, and he'll say, behold the Lamb of God. One writer says, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. One gospel writer says, here it says, and Jesus says, this is the one I'm talking about. This is the one I was telling you about. This is the Messiah. This is the Redeemer. Y'all need to pay attention to this man. In the incarnation, like I said, deity, God himself, was wrapped up in flesh. Jesus fills us, those of us who accept him as Savior. He fills us from, he's got a reservoir of grace, and his bottomless, it doesn't end. And he fills us with truth. How much truth does he fill us with? David said it, until our cups run over. And so John in his gospel goes on to say that the Son of God explained the Father. When Jesus, who was really the divine sculptor, became human clay, his deity was explained in very simple, I think, concrete terms. Verse 18 said, no man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. So John ends his introduction, John the Gospel writer, he ends his introduction right now. These 18 verses were the intro. He has carefully presented his evidence to show that Jesus, who lives in Nazareth, this carpenter's boy, they thought, could be none other than the Son of God. And the reasons he gives, he says, number one, he's eternal. Number two, he's the creator. Number three, he's the source of light. Number four, he is God's manifested glory, glory in the flesh, if you will. And he is the unique explanation of God. In other words, like Jesus told one of his disciples one day. One disciple said, "Look here, Master, show us the Lord and we'll be all right. We'll be cool. Show us the Lord." He said, "Look here." I think it was Philip. He said, "If you've seen me, you've seen my Father." Why? Because the Father and I are one. In part two, I'm going to talk about God's herald. The herald. And of course, you know, a herald is one who announces an event. The herald is one who announces that somebody important is coming to town. And so the background of this herald, well, John the Baptist was the herald. And so the background of this herald is that John had some parents. His daddy was a preacher. He was a priest. His dad was a preacher, Zacharias, and his mama, Elizabeth. But they did not have this baby when they were in their 20s. They were older. And really, they had not expected a baby. And Luke opened his gospel in chapter 1, verse 80. He says, he paints a picture, Luke does, of Jesus from his boyhood until his public ministry. But when he gets to John, he's talking about John was a good boy, but John was a strange boy. And he was a strange adult. And the reason I say, well, he was strange, because John, you know, his daddy had made a pretty good living. John could have stayed and maybe been a priest himself one day, you know. But he didn't do that. John went out on his own to the desert. He went out on his own to the desert. John lived in the desert. Lord have mercy. And so I'll stop right there for this session. And when we come back, we're going to talk about the desert creature. We're going to talk about John in the desert. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal Father, we thank you for your word. For in your word we find strength. In your word we find knowledge. In your word we find truth. In your word we find light. We find those things, Father, that help us in the 21st century to live as your willing servants. Thank you for loving us so much that you have given us your word. And then thank you, first of all, for sending the word, Jesus the Christ, to die for our sins. We pray, Father, for light and enlightenment as we study together the gospel of John. We pray, Father, that we will glean from this gospel those things that we can use for our living today. As always, we ask thy blessings upon those who are ill, upon those who are in darkness, upon those who are confused. We ask thy blessings upon every level of government. We ask our blessings, Father, upon especially this nation. We ask thy blessings upon this world. And Father, as we work through and suffer through this pandemic, we know that we are not by ourselves. We can rely on you. We can trust you. We can depend on you because we already have the evidence. We have a track record. You have brought us this far, and you did not bring us this far to leave us. And so, Father, we're thanking you in advance for what you're getting ready to do in our lives. Thank you again. We thank you for this local church. We thank you for the Church Universal. We ask thy blessings upon all of those who are members of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord, right now. We lift our hands and bow our knees and worship at your throne. We need you, Lord. We need you right now.
Thank you for viewing the Green Castle Baptist Church, the Church Under the Cross online worship experience. We pray that you have been blessed by our ministry. Green Castle Baptist Church is located at 4970 Murphy Lane in Louisville, Kentucky. Our pastor is the Reverend James R. Pitts. Visit us again, and please view our other services on our website at www.greencastle.org. May the Lord bless you and keep you is our prayer.